about 15 minutes. End of the session is going to be question answer session. So you can, the host will enable the chat by 7:45 around. So you can drop in the questions there and I will answer them. So let me share my screen. Yes, the topic for today is basic strategies to eat right nutrition portion. So let us now get into the agenda. What are we going to learn in today's session? One, we will be always, I always like to teach basics because that is a foundation and we will still be brushing the basics today. Those who have attended my last session would probably have understood or learned the basics of nutrition. And we are going to brush that today again and making a balanced plate, which is again a recap of the last session. So those who have missed it can learn it today. Learning about nutrient breakup, difference between whole food and processed food. We will also touch base on the difference. How do you identify whether it's a processed food or a whole food? Importance of measuring the food intake and ways to measure your food. So let us now get into the basics. First thing first, right? So basics is always important in order to learn anything. So what is nutrition? Basics of nutrition, meaning you should understand what is nutrition. I know most of you who have joined here for sure will be knowing the basics at least a little bit. If not, we will be brushing that today. So basics of nutrition. Now, what is a definition of nutrition? If you know, nutrition in simple term or in layman's term, if I have to tell you, nutrition is nothing but the fuel or the requirement of the body's growth and development. The elements required for your body's right growth and development. It is constantly required right from the fetus or right from the mother conceiving the baby until the last breath of the person. So nutrition is constantly required for everybody. The requirement will change stage by stage, depending on age of the person, activity, goal, whatever. Now, in nutrition, like we now saw what is nutrition. So there are six nutrients which are required for us. So they are categorized into two streams. One is macronutrient, one is micronutrient. In macronutrient category, you will be getting these four subcategories, which is your carbohydrate, protein, fat, and fiber. In micronutrient, there are two categories, which are vitamins and minerals. Now, let us also learn or put light into what are these terms, what are carbohydrates, what foods are carbohydrate-rich foods, what food gives us protein, etc. So as I said, there are four macronutrients. Let us now first understand the macronutrients and then go into the micronutrients. Macronutrient, the number one or the important first nutrient comes is a carbohydrate. Now, carbohydrates are energy-giving foods, which are required for instant energy. That means you eat some food that provides you energy, something like electricity or petrol, right? So that if your car has to run, you need to provide that fuel. Similarly, the body requires instant energy, which comes from carbohydrate, which is a glucose, direct form of glucose. Now, what are the examples of carbohydrate? Like all your rice, wheat, ragi, or any of your cereals for that matter. And a little bit complex carbohydrate also comes from vegetables and pulses. Next one is your protein. Now, protein, we might have all learned in school that protein is known as building block of our body. Why is it known as building block of our body? Because protein is responsible for growth and development, repair, and reconstruction of our cells. So our body goes through a lot of wear and tear on a daily basis, even when you're doing any kind of exercise or household chores, or if you're doing any kind of a movement on a daily basis, the cells go through wear and tear. The muscle fiber goes through wear and tear, and there is a breakage of your muscle fiber, which is a natural phenomenon. Now, protein is responsible for rebuilding those because body constantly keeps working. Body is a machine which keeps working constantly day and night. Even when you're sleeping, the body continuously works on repairing the damaged tissues. So protein is something which is very important in rebuilding and reconstruction of the damaged tissues. Protein is also important for absorption of other nutrients, like say absorbing your vitamins and minerals. Protein plays an important role in absorption of certain nutrients as well. Now, what are these foods? If I have to give example about which food you can find protein from, in like both vegetarian as well as non-vegetarian provides us protein. In non-vegetarian source, you will know that it is something which is required, say your meat or fish or eggs. They are direct source of protein for us because they are also muscle, if you understand. So they provide the direct source of protein. In vegetarian source, all your pulses, like your lentils and pulses, chickpeas, your kidney beans, black-eyed peas, all those category of dal and pulses provide us protein, good quality protein, of course. And dairy product also provides us the protein, say soya products, dairy products, dal and pulses, a little bit from whole grains also we get minute amount of protein, but whole grains we do not really consider for protein source, we consider it for the carbohydrate source. The third one is your fat, which is always seen as an enemy because people think, or most of us think, fat makes us fat. That is not true. Fat is also a very important nutrient, which is required for a lot of functions in our body. For example, like I said, for protein, fat also is important for absorption of micronutrients in a major category. So there are various, subcategories in fat, good fat and bad fat, etc. But all in all, what fat is required for us is something which is mostly unsaturated fat, a little bit of saturated fat coming from maybe combination of saturated and unsaturated food, like your milk product. They contain both saturated as well as unsaturated fat. So how much fat is required and how much we should be consuming depends upon what is your body type or your age, your gender, activity factor, medical condition, and a lot of other parameters also should be considered. But fat is also a very important macronutrient. What do we, where do we get fat from? As we all know, like your oil, ghee, butter, even your whole grains and pulses contain a little bit of fat in them, but negligible amount, of course. Your cheese and paneer, those kind of food also provides us fat. Nuts and seeds are also very good source of good fat for us. Next comes is your fiber, which is not included in this picture, but fiber is not really mentioned as a macronutrient in the list of macronutrient because in nutrition science, fiber is also considered as a subcategory of carbohydrate. It is a complex carbohydrate is what is considered it as. So fiber is something which is, again, there are two subcategories for the, which is soluble fiber and insoluble fiber. As the name indicates, soluble fiber means it is digestible. Insoluble fiber means it is not digestible. So fiber is majorly responsible for the excretion purpose plus the absorption of nutrient in the intestine. So in soluble fiber, example is your oats, fruits, something like your guava or papaya are very good example for soluble fiber. Insoluble fiber is something which is from your vegetable, leafy vegetables, your psyllium husk or the isabgol, or your anything which, any vegetable which gives us the fiber invisible, like beans, for example. These are all insoluble fiber. They are mainly responsible for creating the stool bulk. That means to avoid constipation, to help your body push out all the unwanted leftovers from digesting the food. Last one is your water. Yes, water is also considered as one of the nutrient because it gives us a lot of function. One, it is responsible for maintaining the hydration. It's responsible for maintaining the mineral balance. It is also responsible for improving your metabolic rate and digestive function, etc. And the last category of your nutrition is your subcategory is your vitamins and minerals. Now, carbohydrate, fat, fiber, and water are your and protein are your macronutrients. Vitamins and minerals are your micronutrients. Now, if I have to explain vitamins and minerals, it will take a longer time because it's a vast subject altogether. But in simple terms, if I have to tell you, vitamins and minerals are something which are necessary for a lot of functions in our body. For example, your eyesight. You might have heard that vitamin A is responsible for good eyesight. Vitamin D, that is responsible for a lot of functions in our body, for your bone health, your digestive health, your hormonal balance, etc. Similarly, calcium, iron, these are minerals required for us. So where do we find these vitamins and minerals? To keep it simple for you guys, you have to look at having whole grains, nuts and seeds, different colored fruits and vegetables, which are in season. So these things mostly provide us the required vitamins and minerals. So that kind of brushes out your basics of nutrition required for normal functioning of our body. Now, let us also just have a look at how can you make your plate? What does your plate contain, or what should your plate contain? If you look at this picture here on the right-hand side, you will see build a balanced plate. And you can see a plate symbol here. And imagine you are dividing your plate into four parts. Out of four parts, the first two parts should be filled with vegetables. It can be raw vegetables or cooked vegetables, but half of your plate should come from vegetables. This small yellow circle in the center, that says the amount of fat which should be consumed on a daily basis. Now, since oil is used as a cooking media, it is already taken care in our intake, right? So you don't really specifically have to add any fat on top of your food. But you may ask me, is adding ghee okay? If you are considering your total day's fat intake, I will also explain how much can you have in a day. A teaspoon of ghee is definitely going to give you good omega fatty acids. But remember, ghee should not be reheated. Meaning, to make ghee, you have to heat butter, right? So once the butter is heated to a certain temperature for a certain number of minutes or hour, whatever, it is turned into ghee. And it comes into a semi-solid consistency. And if the temperature is too low, it gets into solid consistency. That is because ghee contains higher percentage of saturated fat. Now, because it's an animal source. Now, when you're eating ghee, you're not supposed to reheat it or expose it to a higher temperature again, because it is rich in omega-3, omega-6, and omega-9 fatty acid. These omega fatty acids are heat liable. That means when you expose this to certain temperature and above, they are lost. So in order to get the benefits of ghee, it is always recommended to eat them as they are, like raw. Just before eating your food, you can add that half a teaspoon of ghee on your rice or your roti and consume it. But it should all consider how much oil do you use for cooking as well. Now, the yellow quadrant here that says healthy carbs, this out of the second half, you divide it into further quarter, and one quarter should come from carbohydrate. As I mentioned earlier, carbohydrate sources are mostly your bread, rice, roti, poha, upma in your Indian food categories. Also, your sweet potato or any roots and tuber come under carbohydrate category. 1/4 of your plate can contain that much, your carbohydrate. And the last 1/4 should come from protein source. Now, it can be vegetarian source or it can be non-vegetarian source. If you're, for example, if I have to give you an example of a plate, say you have taken 1/4 of your plate, you have taken rice, for example. Now, the size of the plate also depends on how much you're consuming. So if you take like a bigger size of plate, of course, your total calories are going to go high. But this is like an example that you should be looking at 1/4 of your serving. So the plate, when I mean here, is a serving. So 1/4 of your serving should come from, say you have taken rice, you have taken some lentil curry, and you have taken half of your plate you have taken with cooked vegetable, or 1/4 of the plate you have taken cooked vegetable, and 1/4 of your plate you have taken raw vegetable, and a glass of water by the side. So this makes your meal a complete meal in nutrition terms. If you have to explain, this is a complete meal which provides you all the nutrients, considering you have taken good vegetables, different colored vegetables, to provide the micronutrients. If you look at this explanation here, it may not really so much hold good for Indian foods, but I will explain it in simple terms. So protein, this orange thing here, what can come from protein is your fish, beans, eggs, milk, lean meat. It's always recommended to go for white meat over red meat, simply because red meat contains more fat percentage and the risk of your uric acid, etc., going high is higher. So it is better to consume white meat over red meat and keep the red meat limited. And tofu, yogurt, etc., are your protein source. And the green thing, vegetables, any vegetable for that matter, considering you're not going too high on underground vegetables like your potatoes or your carrots, beetroot, etc., they are very important. They do contain a lot of nutrients. But depending on your goal, age, etc., the amount of your roots and tubers needs to be decided. And if you're consuming more of roots and tuber, this healthy carb here, they contribute to this, and you'll have to reduce on your cereals. Now, the healthy carbs, this comes to the yellow part here. That is your whole wheat, whole wheat bread. But if you are taking whole wheat in any form, oats, brown rice, any of your sweet potato, corn, these all come under healthy carbohydrates. And this orange thing here, that is your fat. Now, considering you need to be using oil for cooking. Now, let me tell you how much oil does a household require. Every person, the budget for a person per month is 0.5 liter. So if you're a family of four, then you should be somewhere around 2 liter oil requirement per month. So if you're going more than that, then you probably might have to go back and check how much oil is used on a daily basis. And if you use deep frying as a choice, if you're using deep frying, then of course you need to make sure that once deep fried oil, once used oil, should not be reused, simply because there are like the molecules in your oil is such a way that there are double bonds between two molecules. When you expose it to a heating point, when you are boiling the oil, the double bond is broken down into single bond. Now, what does this bond mean? Double bond is more complex. Single bond is more simple. So the more single bond that you consume, the chances of your triglyceride, the bad cholesterol, going high is higher. So you need to make sure that limit your deep fried food from outside. And when you're deep frying food at home, use the oil only for once. And the remaining oil has to be discarded. I hope this simple plate has given you kind of idea what should your plate contain. Now, let us go into how much of food you should be eating. That is also something which is covered in the last session. So it is a brush up. Those who have not attended can learn it now. Those who have attended can brush your memory. So out of your plate, now we saw that your plate should contain so-and-so nutrient and divide your plate into so-and-so thing, right? Now, how much of carbohydrate in percentage-wise? If you have been consulting a nutritionist, or if you have been using Healthify Me app, you will always see these numbers. You sometimes probably may or may not have understood what these numbers mean. So, like I said, in nutrition, now nutrition is fuel. They also provide calorie. The fuel for us is measured in terms of calorie, like how we have volt or whatever in our electricity, right? So in calories, we'll have to see how much of percentage of calorie comes from all these nutrients that we just discussed about. So you have to see here in this picture, if you see, 50% of your total carbohydrates should come from sorry, 50% of your total calories should come from carbohydrates. Now, if you look at what carbohydrate you should be taking, if you go back to the previous slide and check, it should come from whole grains, majorly. Carbohydrates can come from fruits, it can come from cakes, it can come from sugar, rice, brown rice, white rice, whole wheat, ragi, millet, all of these can give you carbohydrate. Even dal and pulses will give you carbohydrate. This 50% of carbohydrate should be coming from a combination of whole grain and pulses and not from simple sugar. Something like your glucose, cakes, biscuits, chocolates, jaggery, maybe your sugar, maybe if you're drinking five, six cups of coffee, with every cup having 1 teaspoon of sugar, automatically your total carbohydrate is going to shot up just by simple carbohydrate. So having a balanced meal is something which is very important in order to provide those nutrients for the body, right? So you should see that you're having maximum of your whole grain and pulses as your source of carbohydrate. Now, 25% should come from protein. 25% of your calories should come from protein. That can be your meat, your eggs, your fish or dal, pulses, lentil, paneer, tofu, etc. 25% calories should come from fat. Now, each gram of carbohydrate provides you 4 kilocalories. 1 gram of carbohydrate gives you 4 kilocalories. 1 gram of protein gives you 4 kilocalories. And 1 gram of fat gives you 9 kilocalories. So when you're dividing your calories into this 50% carbs, 25% protein and 25% fat, the gram is going to be different because protein and carbohydrate provides you similar calorie and fat gives you higher calorie. I hope that was clear. If you have any question, make a note of it and you can ask me at the end of the session. Now, let us get into importance of measuring your food. So, importance of measuring food. Sorry. So, why do we have to measure food? So, now we spoke about the percentage. We spoke about dividing the plate. We also spoke about how much are we supposed to be eating in terms of nutrient category. Now, let us come into how much should we be eating as a food, right? That is common. That is a common thing that we are going to be seeing on our plate on a daily basis. Now, firstly, let us see the importance of measuring your food. Why is it important? One, it helps the stomach size get back into original shape and size. What does this mean? This simply means that understand our human anatomy. If you have to simply know your stomach, if you have ever seen anatomy picture of human being, you can Google it after the session. So it will tell you the digestive system is like packed engine, like you see your car engine. So our body also has like digestive system having the multiple organs packed in our abdominal area. Stomach is the only organ which can expand and shrink down. No other organ can change its size apart from uterus during pregnancy. But stomach is an only organ which can expand and adjust to this amount of food what we eat on a daily basis. It doesn't change on day one to day two. It generally said that it takes about 3 weeks for your stomach size to get adjusted to a portion size. Say the size of a stomach, if you can see this, when you hold your hand together, this is the size of my stomach. Similarly, depending on your hand size, the size of the stomach will be according to your hand size. So imagine you eat some amount of food on a daily basis, which is say this much. You end up eating 25% more than your requirement. Initially, you feel overly full. Eventually, you get adjusted and you feel comfortable with that amount of food. And suddenly you decide that now you want to eat less and you start eating only this much. The remaining 25 or 50% of food that you have been eating earlier, that is going to be making you feel hungry and you think that you're not full. And your mind starts panicking that you're hungry, you're not eating enough. So the wise thing to do is combining your nutrient that we will probably touch base on the coming slides. So it is important to measure the food because you haven't been measuring so far. You probably do not know how much you should be eating. So to clear the confusion, to know exactly how much is required for you and how much your body should be eating on a daily basis, measuring is something which is going to be useful. Second point is to get mindfulness in place. So measuring food helps you know that how much you should be eating. Most of the times we go wrong in how much we should be eating. We probably eat in stress while watching TV or talking to somebody or working. So your brain does not really actually register that you have eaten something. So you will eat something in hurry or diverting your mind. And after a while, your mind says that you have not eaten food. That's when you start feeling hungry, even after eating some stomach full of food. So to get that mindfulness in place, you need to be measuring your food. So the third point is to prove the right nutrition, provide the right nutrition for the body. This goes into the first point again, where when you're measuring your food, you can actually divide your nutrients into your carbohydrate, protein, vitamin, mineral, etc., right? So if you don't measure, you would not really know how much of what you're eating. So it is important for you to measure how much. To avoid overeating, this is again, as I mentioned, when you measure it, and practice a one serve meal. It always helps you eat only so much how much is required for your body. The last point is to help balance the nutrition. So these are some of the important points which is necessary for us to understand why we should be measuring our food. So now how to measure? There are multiple ways that you can measure your food. You can measure using a hand, which is a traditional age-old method to measure food. You can use cups, you can use measuring scale, you can use home level katori cups if you know how much do they actually weigh. And let me clear this one thing here, that you don't have to really measure everything forever in your life. Measurement is something which is very necessary for your mind and body to have that guidance. Now, when you don't know how much to eat, it is important for you to guide your mind and your stomach to know that this is the portion that you're supposed to be eating at one meal. And you will be surprised that when you measure some amount of food for some time, after a while, automatically you will know that this much food is something which is enough for you, neither too less nor too much. So even your stomach will tell you when you eat some food after a point, it will tell you that you're full and you don't need to eat anything more, unless you are partying or eating something too much where you want to still stuff yourself with a lot of food and feel this food is in your throat. But otherwise, your stomach actually tells you that you need to stop eating. Now, the basic traditional way of measuring is using your hand. If you look at the picture here, so it says it divides your nutrient into the size of your palm. So the palm size, like a size of a palm, is only this, not along with your finger here. So only the size of your palm is supposed to be your protein source. So this is your per meal quantity that this is explaining. So a size of your palm, say if you're taking a piece of fish or a chicken, piece of chicken, for example, or if you're taking paneer, if you're taking dal. So approximately when you serve things on your plate and when you're keeping your hand on top of it, it should cover the area of your palm. That is the amount of protein that is recommended per meal. Now, a fist is when you close your fist, how much? Like when you're putting your vegetable on your plate and if you're closing your fist and covering it, how much does that area cover? That much of vegetable is required. Serving handful of carbohydrate, how much fits inside your palm? That much is the amount of carbohydrate required. And a thumb size is your fat. Now, as I said, if you calculate your monthly budget of fat, and if you don't deep fry your food, the fat will automatically be taken care. But however, recommended amount is 1 tablespoon of oil per meal. That is your thumb size. It is said that size of your thumb is almost approximately 15 ml. So this is your hand measurements that you can use. Next measure is your utilizing cups. If you have come across this baking cups, people who bake and all will know this measuring cups, but you will also see it in supermarkets easily that the measuring cups with written the gram values, it will have right from 1 cup to 1/2 cup, 1/4 cup, tablespoon, spoon, etc. You can use them also to know your quantity measures. You can here, this is an example given. This is what your Healthify Me app also explains to you. So I thought explaining this would be more easier. So a katori is 150 ml. Either a small bowl or a katori is 150 ml. A teacup is 180 ml. A bowl is 350 ml. There is one more measure, which is a cup, that is 250 ml. A glass is again 250 ml. And large glass is 350 ml. So this is the measure what you will see in Healthify Me app, which is like standard measure. You can use these measurements or your baking cup measures, which are standard again, which can be used to understand the portion size. Now, the last method is more specified method. It is more accurate because you will know exactly how much. So using a kitchen scale, that is going to give you exactly how much. Like if you weigh an apple, it says 100 gram, 200 gram. So you exactly know how much. And if you use any calorie tracker or even Healthify Me, you will get the actual measure of the nutrient combination. So using a kitchen scale can also be useful in terms of knowing your household measures. Like every house has different cups, katoris, bowls. The sizes are very different. So if you have a kitchen scale, you can measure your cups, bowls, katoris and see what is the quantity that fits into. And then you can use those spoons or cups on a daily basis to serve. So you don't have to literally weigh your food every now and then. If you do it like a practice for a couple of sessions, you will kind of understand that this particular cup gives me 200 gram, this particular spoon gives me 5 gram or 15 gram. So these are the measurement guides that generally is useful to give you an idea how much of food you should be eating. Now there's one more method which is used by a lot of old people. You might have heard your parents or grandparents talking about it. This is something to do with mindfulness. Now, I want you to listen carefully, and if you have a question on it, you can even write it on the chat box when we are ready. So this is something without measuring anything in hand. You're going to be eating food and your stomach is going to tell you how much you should be eating. So firstly, it is said that you should divide, like how we divided our plate into quadrants, you should divide your stomach into imaginary quadrants. So it says, this theory says, half of your stomach should be filled with solid food, that is your vegetables, pulses, cereals or whatever. 1/4 of your stomach should be filled with liquid. It can be your dal, curry, buttermilk, curd, whatever. And 1/4 of your stomach should be left empty for a better digestion. So that means when you're eating your food, if you realize, most of the times we don't realize this, if you realize, you will have a point where you feel neither too full nor hungry. So you're comfortable. Now, how do you know this? You have to eat slow. So each bite, you might have heard this again, each bite has to be chewed for 32 times, they say. If not for 32 times, try chewing for 15 times. So when you eat slow, without any distractions, without watching TV or without doing your work, you will realize that your satisfaction is top notch. You don't really feel like overeating. You don't really feel like eating something or nibbling something 1 hour after eating your lunch. This generally happens. Your mind is not really registering what you have eaten. So it takes 20 minutes for your mind to register that you have eaten something. But in 20 minutes, we can eat so much, right? So you should eat slow. You should measure your food, put it onto your plate and practice chewing properly and eating. So this will make your quantity restriction If you're looking at losing weight, it will help you in losing weight. If you start measuring your nutrient combinations, it will give you a balanced nutrition, and your overall health, your growth, development, everything will get into a better progress. So this is all about the measuring and the basics of nutrition. So host, please open the chat box so that we can take up questions. Let me stop sharing the session. Yes. I have covered the basics. Now, if you have any questions on this, the portion, the measurement, combination, and sorry, I missed one more point. That is difference between processed and whole food. I will quickly cover it by the time you put in the questions for me here. So difference between whole food and processed food. Now, whole food is something which is natural. Processed food is something which has longer shelf life. For example, you have muesli and you have oats. Muesli goes in a lot of processing compared to oats. Or you eat upma for breakfast and you eat chocos for breakfast. Chocos goes in a lot of processing. Upma does not really go into processing. The only processing happens is from wheat to rava. So you should always look at taking foods which are less processed as much as natural food, which will be high in nutrient and it will not really be refined also. So let me take up questions. Difference between baked food, baked potato and boiled potato, which is good to consume? Both are same. There is no difference. If you ask me baked potato and fried potato, then that is a difference. But baked and boiled, both are same. No difference in them. White rice or brown rice? I would say brown rice simply because white rice is more processed. Again, it is polished. The nutrient in the top coat of your brown rice is removed. So the amount of B complex vitamins that is present in your coating of rice is being completely removed. So your white rice gets into more starchy. It does give you a little bit of nutrients, but it is not a complete nutrient balance. So it is, if possible, to switch over to brown rice, it's always good. Best time to eat fruit as a meal alone, like say in between, mid-meal, like in between your breakfast and lunch or in between your lunch and dinner as a pre-workout or as a snack in between the day when you are hungry. Fruit is a better choice. Try not to combine fruits with your major meal when your stomach is full because it will give you a lot of extra fructose, which is glucose again. So when you're eating fruits as a meal alone, the absorption of the nutrient is much better. How healthy are breads available in the market? I would say 50-50. Even if they say it is a whole wheat or multi-grain or whatever, if you try baking bread at home, you will see that the bread that you bake at home comes in so hard with your wheat alone. And the market-made whole wheat bread is so soft and it is just tasty as your white bread. So check the ingredient. It always says 45% of your maida and 55% of whole wheat, and they can project it as whole wheat. It's sad that how they get licensed to project it as whole wheat bread, having 50% refined flour, but that is how it works. So you have to decide on the frequency of eating your bread. Timing for meal. I would say there is no specific timings for your meal unless you have like a very erratic schedule. So I would say divide your day into what time you wake up until what time you sleep, the number of hours that you are awake, and then identify the number of hours that you are immobile. Mostly post 8 o'clock, we do not move anywhere, right? Even before that, now, since we are all working from home, the movement is restricted. But even otherwise, if you see, when the sun sets or later in the day, in the night, we do not have so much activity. So Divide your day into, say, morning if you wake up at 6 o'clock or 8 o'clock. Divide your day from then till 8 in the evening, like 12 hours you divide your day. And then place your meals into every 3 hours, you're eating a small portion of meal. So that will kind of help you have in-time food. Dry fruits and nuts come under what category? Mostly micronutrients and fat. Dry fruits come under micronutrients. They provide you a lot of vitamins and minerals. Nuts come under your fat, healthy fat. Plus, they also provide you omega fatty acids, as they are also good in some micronutrients like your minerals and vitamins. So they can be categorized as micronutrient. Explain 4 kilocalories in carb protein fat. Okay, so that was the amount of calorie distribution per gram of carb protein and fat. So each gram of carbohydrate gives us 4 kilocalories. Kilocalorie or calorie, like calorie in C capital, it is what generally we mention, but 4 kilocalorie per gram of carbohydrate. Now, per gram of protein also provides us the same amount of calorie. So if you are eating carbohydrate or protein, calorie wise, they're going to be the same. Fat gives us 9 calorie per gram, like 1 gram of fat gives us 9 kilocalories. So the distribution that you saw, 25% protein, 25% fat, 50% carbohydrate, comes from the amount of calories provided. Secondly, we cannot eat equal amount of protein and carbohydrate simply because the if I don't know if you understand this, the metabolic thing, like we go through a lot of studies on the end product of metabolism of carbohydrate, protein, fiber, etc. So they require different enzymes. They release a different type of enzyme. They release different types of ATP, etc. So that is important for us to understand. And that's why it is divided into 50% should come from carbohydrate, considering fiber also comes from carbohydrate category. So the 50% that we see is not just from cereals. It comes from fruits and vegetables, etc. also. So that's when your 50% should come from carbs, 25 and each should come from fat and protein. How to measure and track the food when we eat outside? It's a little tricky. Now, if you practice eating your thumb rule, hand rule, probably you can guess the amount of food when you're eating from outside. That is the only thing that you can do probably. Once you practice eating the portion at home, once you know how much does it look like, you start measuring 200 grams of rice and you put it on your plate and you start eating it, do it for a few weeks. You will know that when you put 200 grams of food on your plate, you will know, like I can actually identify the quantity of food because I've been doing it since years. Similarly, when you start practicing it, you actually get to know this will be approximately this amount of quantity. So you will come to a conclusion that outside food, what you have eaten can be around the same. So at least approximation will give you that little match about the quantity that you log. Roti or rice, both. Both have the same calories, same nutrients, maybe a little bit fiber more in roti. But if you're buying the atta from market, the fiber content also is not very, very much. But if you are making your own atta, you're adding bran to it, the fiber content will increase. So both. Eating bread is okay. What is cool? What cooking oil do you suggest? I would suggest all vegetable oil according to the oil that you have eaten growing up in your locality. Like I come from South India, where I come from a place where a lot of coconut oil is used, not Kerala, but Karnataka. So there we grow coconut and coconut oil is used year through. So I grew up like that. So I still continue using coconut oil. So if you come from a place where mustard oil is used, you can continue using mustard oil. But however, whichever oil you use, you should remember the budget per person. 4 teaspoons per day, that's about 20 ml. 1 teaspoon is 5 ml. So 20 ml per person per day. So if you're cooking for 4 people, then you actually have a provision to use more oil. If you measure using your spoon, you will be surprised to see that much oil is actually not necessary. You just have to change the method, that's all. And yeah, so if you're using a 4 teaspoon of oil and ghee, I would say if you're maintaining your weight, if you do not have any health conditions or whatever, 4 teaspoon oil plus half a teaspoon of solid ghee or melted ghee, like a teaspoon is okay. But if you're in a fat restricted diet because of your cholesterol or your weight loss or whatever reason, then you might have to reduce your oil and combine your 1 teaspoon ghee along with it. Ghee should be consumed without cooking, yes. Is animal protein more good than plant protein? Nothing like that. Both have their own goodness. It is a debatable topic again. But however, animal protein contains some nutrients which your plant protein may or may not provide you. Similarly, plant protein will contain some nutrient which your animal protein may not really provide you. So it is, if you're a non-vegetarian, I would say it is good for you to combine both the protein sources. If you're a vegetarian, it is always good for you to combine two different sources of protein, like say two types of dals or three types of pulses together, or you're having one dairy product and a dal. Making a combination always helps you to improve the amino acid quality. When can we have sugar? Sugar you can have maybe 1 to 2 teaspoons in a day. You can consume sugar. But if you're eating sweets every now and then, probably it's not recommended. So that's why we always have a concept of cheat meal, that you can enjoy what you like to eat periodically, say once every 7 days or once every 10 days. You can enjoy what you really like. So giving free food for yourself is always dangerous. Difference between jaggery and sugar, calorie wise or carbohydrate wise, there is no difference. Both provide you the same calories, same carbohydrate, and same glycemic index also. If you understand glycemic index, it's the amount of blood sugar that your body absorbs after eating sugar or jaggery. That is also the same. Probably the only difference is the nutrient factor. Jaggery will contain some amount of iron and calcium, which your sugar may not. That's the only difference. So eating jaggery sweet is not a license to eat more sweet. Foods for tummy fat reduction. There is no food that will reduce fat. So let us not even discuss about it. How many grams of fat can you eat approximately when you're trying to lose weight? When you're trying to lose weight, anywhere between 15 to 25% of your total calories is recommended from fat. So in the slide, 25, 25, 50 carbs, where does the fiber come in? Yes. So I explained it just before. I'll explain it again. 50%, like you will only see carbohydrate, fat, and protein. You did not see fiber in it. That's because fiber is also considered as a source of complex carbohydrate. So when you're eating the 50% calorie coming from carbohydrates, that should also contain your vegetables, fruits, whole grains. All these things will provide you the carbs. It's not that if you're eating, say, 1,500 calories, 750 calories should come from rice alone or chapatis alone. That is not true. So when you're dividing your entire day's intake from pulses, dal, your rice or chapati or poha, idli, all these things put together along with your vegetables and fruits also. Is it good to have masala oats? It's again processed. I would say masala oats contains, if you check the packet, you will know that it contains a lot of other preservatives and extra sodium and extra salt. So I would not recommend eating masala oats as a staple on a daily basis. Rather, you can use your oats you can make your upma using oats. Just roast your upma the way you do for your rava and make it just the way you make your rava upma, oats upma can also be made and it comes out tasty. I live alone, can't cook again and again. What green vegetables can be included that are easy to cook and fast? You can cook once and eat the same thing for two times a day. That can also be done. You can divide your meals into multiple nutrients as I just explained. You can eat all vegetables. You can eat all pulses. So try to have one protein source and one vegetable source along with your carbohydrate and repeat the meal for both lunch as well as dinner. Amul Tetra Pak milk, actually a milk that will really require nutrients. Tetra Pak is considered as a way of preservation, but without any added preservatives. So Tetra Packing is something which goes through, I mean, the process is such that they pack your milk or any food in such a way that there is no room for microbial activity. So that's when Tetra Packing is considered as a safe way of preserving food. But again, I would not say Tetra Packing is bad, or I would not really say that you should always look for Tetra Packing. So if you like considering the era or considering the convenience, etc., if you're looking at low fat milk, of course, you'll have to go for Tetra Packing. And Tetra Packing can be consumed also, but depending on your convenience, I think you can go ahead with it. Can we eat potato? Is it good for weight loss? Potato is again simply made enemy, I think. Potato is not bad, but if you are eating a lot of potato along with the amount of carbs that you're eating, it will increase your total carbohydrate. So if you decide to eat potato, you have to decide on how much other your grains are also included in your meal. So if you're eating like chapati with aloo sabzi, both are going to be carbohydrates, not going to help you. Does eating egg yolk help while muscle building? Egg yolk is nothing to do with muscle building. Egg yolk is a source of a lot of nutrients. It contains both saturated and unsaturated fat. It contains cholesterol. It contains vitamin D. It is a source of calcium and iron as well. Since it contains higher percentage of fat, if you're on a fat restricted diet, it might not really support. So you will have to decide on how much of egg yolk that you can eat. Kurmura is healthy or not? Yes, it is. You can eat kurmura. It's not an unhealthy choice. Gain weight fastly. Eat high calorie foods which are wholesome, nuts and dry fruits. The question is for weight gain. So if you want to gain weight, you should understand that your calorie expenditure should be less than calorie intake. And you should also do exercises for a better absorption of your nutrient. So eating high calorie food can happen from pizzas and burgers also, but that doesn't mean that you should be eating pizza for weight gain. You should be eating healthy, wholesome meal which are higher calorie. And trust me, it is not easy to eat high calorie food from healthy source because you will have to eat like a lot of combination of meals. You may probably take help from somebody to learn the details about it so that your weight gain will be healthier weight gain. Does this portion apply on weight gain? Yes, it does apply on weight gain also. Probably the quantity of your food will decide on how much calorie you're going to be eating. Can we eat only dry fruits, nuts, egg whites, milk as daily breakfast? Yes, you can, but I would recommend eating a little bit of carbohydrate along with it. Maybe add some oats or something along with it to make it a complete meal. Because if you lack carbohydrates in your breakfast, you will end up craving for sugar by the end of the day. You will start craving sugar and you will end up eating something wrong. So it is always good for you to do a well-balanced breakfast. This combination is good. Nuts, fruits, milk, eggs, maybe add a little bit of oats along with it. Make like a bowl and that would be good for you. I will take last two questions. when I try maintaining calories in my daily meals through Healthify Me, after some days I found my body weak. How do we tackle this problem? I would not be able to answer it here in this platform. I think you can reach out to any nutritionist in the platform like Healthify Me. Any nutritionist will be able to help you understand if you are eating right or not. Sometimes if you have put your goal in certain manner, the app will create some calorie balance which may not really suit you. Secondly, you might be deficient on some nutrient like your maybe vitamin D or B12 or hemoglobin, etc. They will also make you feel weak. So that the area of identification or your discovery is something which is very important. Why do you feel weak? And then a coach will be able to guide you with it. Spinach comes under which category? It comes under micronutrient and fiber. Spinach is a good source of iron and calcium. It is a good source of fiber as well. So eating spinach is good. Vitamin capsules are safe. I would say, now touch basing the last question, I mean last point on supplements, I personally believe supplementation is not bad, but if you're only doing supplements, they are bad. Meaning you should take care about your diet. You should take care about your supplementation depending on your body's requirement. So supplement, as the name suggests, it is important to understand that supplement should support your nutrient requirement. So after the age of 30, I would recommend getting your blood test done at least once a year if you are keeping healthy. If you're having any kind of a blood parameter changes like your cholesterol or whatever, it is better to check yourself every 3 to 6 months to see what is your blood levels, and based on which, if you're deficient on something, say common deficiency is your iron, calcium, vitamin D and vitamin B12. These are commonly seen deficiencies. So you can consider having multivitamin capsules or multivitamin supplements with a periodic supplementation. Say any of these vitamin supplements, they are recommended to do like a course. So you can do it like a course of 30 to 60 days, and you should give a gap of at least 30 to 60 days before doing the second course, with of course suggestion from either any of a healthcare provider, a doctor or a nutritionist. I have a lot of questions. I will try answering the most commonly asked, maybe. Which protein powder is good? There are many brands in market. You can go ahead with any leading brand, but see that you are buying from authentic source. I would just want to say that, because it's a huge scam world out there for protein supplement. So you might end up having duplicate products if you don't know from where you have to buy. So you should always buy from an authentic seller who can actually give you the right product. Can you suggest protein source equal to egg in vegetarian? Okay. Each gram of egg provides you 3 grams of protein, anywhere between 3 to 4 grams based on the size of the egg. So if you have to replace egg with any vegetarian food, you can replace with a cup of curd, or you can take a cup of mixed pulses. They are also a good source of protein. Or you can take a piece of paneer, which is also going to give you some amount of protein. So depending on how is your meal plate going to be made, you can decide on replacement of eggs or meat. Okay, one interesting question. I think this will be the last one. Most common wrong combination of food. Somebody is asking, can you name some wrong combination of food? There is nothing in such wrong combination of food, but I would say there is incomplete combination of food. Say, for example, if you're eating 2 sabzi and roti, 2 varieties of sabzi, and roti as your meal. That is not a complete meal. Or if you're eating rasam rice, for example, if you're a South Indian, you will commonly be eating rasam rice. That is also not complete. It's not wrong, but it's not complete, because sabzis will give you fiber. Roti is going to give you carbohydrate. Where is your protein? There is no protein. So instead of doing two sabzis, you could probably do one sabzi, one dal and roti. You can, if you have time and patience, you can add on some salad along. Otherwise, simply eat little extra sabzis to make your fiber go higher. Coming to your rice combination that I just mentioned, if you are eating rasam rice, it's absolutely fine. You can add like a cup of, say, whole pulses salad. So that will kind of help you have a better combination. Or simply adding a cup of curd and some salad along with your rasam rice is a complete meal. So great. I will have to end this session here. I hope it was useful. I hope you learned a little bit at least. And if you have any further question, you can reach out to any nutritionist from the team and they will definitely be able to clear your doubts. And hoping to see you all soon. This is Dr. Priyanka signing off. Until next time, bye-bye.